At this time, I think we ought to ask the panel members for this next panel, which is panel four on commercial and industrial opportunities, to come to the table. We literally, I think, are back about on time. It's the same system as yesterday. There is one or two panelists who are not at the table, but they're on the front row, and they'll be participating in this panel, which is headed by Brewster Shaw, who's an astronaut, Boeing vice president, general manager of space operations, explorations at Boeing. Brewster, thank you for being here.
Thank you very much.
Well, those are a couple of really interesting ad lib presentations. I have a very high appreciation for the cocktails that MD Anderson offers on occasion. My wife is approaching 5 years of remission from leukemia as a result of one of MD Anderson's cocktails, so that's near and dear to my heart. And I can't wait to hear the engineering discussion about the redundancy that will be required to keep the temperature in those beds at exactly 15 degrees centigrade before we head off. So that'll be fun. Well, welcome to the commercial and industrial opportunities panel. Let's see, one, two, three. We're not quite all here yet. Who are we missing? Okay. Babs was here yesterday. I saw her. Okay. She'll be here shortly. Who? Oh, Ken Reitler? He's right here. He's right here. Right. So we're just missing Babs. I think we'll get going. I'd like to thank Cheryl Kelly of Boeing for helping in the preparation of this panel. As was mentioned, my name is Brewster Shaw, and I am joined, fortunately, today by this distinguished panel to discuss some of the science and technology that lends itself to commercial enterprises, specific devices that have been or are in development, and the obstacles and opportunities associated with space science and commercial spin-offs. After each of the panelists provides opening remarks, we'll open it up for questions from the floor. I've got several. I'm sure that you will as well, and I look forward to that time. Let's see. Dr. Ignatiev was on the schedule to be on the panel. Unfortunately, he's unable to be here today, so we won't be hearing from him. So we're gathering at a pretty exciting time for space-based and travel-related enabling research. If all goes as planned, this month we will have six crew members on the International Space Station living full-time on orbit, conducting scientific research in a unique environment that only this engineering marvel can offer. Currently, the ISS, International Space Station, is our only option for long-term human-tended research in space. You all probably know Bob Bigelow has a couple of small inflatables on orbit at this time, but he desperately needs a human transportation capability before he'll be able to initiate commercial operations with human beings. Other nations have expressed interest in developing their own orbiting laboratory capabilities, but those appear to be some time off. As was mentioned, I work for Boeing, and as NASA's prime contractor for the space station, we take special pride in this joint NASA International Partner in Industry achievement. Recently, another space shuttle crew delivered and installed the last major piece of U.S.-provided hardware to the space station, a Boeing-built power module that enabled the station to reach its full power capability and now can provide 30 kilowatts of power for science investigations on board. The International Space Station supports a variety of pure and applied research for the U.S. and our international partners. It also plays a critical role in support of the U.S. space exploration policy by aligning our scientific research to support exploration objectives, including medical countermeasures for long-term human space travel and the development of enabling technologies. Additionally, ISS continues to demonstrate the value of human involvement in space exploration to accurately assess unforeseen events and properly address them to maintain overall mission objectives. ISS expedition crews conduct science daily across a wide variety of fields, including life and physical sciences, and those opportunities will continue to increase with time. Crews also perform Earth observations as well as education and technology demonstrations. Currently, there are 19 research facilities on board ISS. Of these, 9 are NASA-sponsored, 8 are ESA, or European Space Agency-sponsored, and 2 are sponsored by JAXA, the Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency. In the upcoming expeditions, there will be additional facilities delivered for an expected 24 facilities when ISS International Assembly is fully complete. In the years since permanent human presence began aboard the station, expedition crews have conducted some 155 integrated investigations serving over 600 scientists globally. The 2005 NASA Authorization Act designated the U.S. segment of the ISS as a national laboratory and directed NASA to develop a plan to increase the utilization of the ISS by other federal entities and the private sector. As the nation's newest national laboratory, the ISS will further strengthen relationships among NASA, other federal entities, and private sector leaders in the pursuit of national priorities for the advancement of science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Boeing is working on projects that will help the science community utilize the ISS, including creating a simpler, streamlined user interface and a virtual user guide. These things will help make it easier for scientists to utilize the station for upcoming research, and there are already important Pathfinder projects and research taking place on station. I bet I'm going really fast for those translators, aren't I? Sorry. Early science on Skylab, Spacelab, Spacehab, Salyut, Mir, and now ISS has taught us much about what to expect when all the research facilities are operational and available. From physiology to physics, many hypotheses about what will happen without gravity are being challenged. Data from these experiments are causing scientists to rethink existing models and propose different approaches and observations as they seek to understand new data from orbit. Rather than waiting years for the next flight opportunity, ISS discoveries generate new hypotheses that can often be tested in a short period of time in the same way that a scientist would follow provocative findings in a laboratory on Earth. Examples are in the engineering and technology area, new energy storage systems, plant and animal research at the biocell level that can lead to better understanding of infectious diseases. We'll hear more about that. And the National Lab Pathfinder Vaccine 1B experiment is a commercial payload serving as a pathfinder. It contains, well, I'll let Jeannie tell us all about that. So in concert with the theme of this panel, I believe that the enticing commercial companies to execute medical sciences research on space platforms represents a tremendous opportunity to advance the global well-being of the human species. Now let's make no mistake. We Yankees have been a little bit non-consistent in our approach. We designed and built the International Space Station with a model of utilization in mind. Then with the advent of the vision for space exploration, much of the science that had been planned for years to be conducted on ISS was canceled by the agency. And then we declare it a national laboratory and encourage the other agencies and private sector to become involved in research. And it followed on the heels of that is the retirement of the space shuttle, which is our main logistics carrier for ISS utilization. So, an interesting question that I would really like the panelists to think about as they deliver their remarks and will address hopefully after remarks are finished is, given that we have this logistics problem where we're going to be dependent upon Russian, European, and Japanese logistics carriers for the foreseeable future with limited up mass and no down mass capability, What is the greatest barrier to commercial utilization of ISS for medical sciences research and development? I think that'll be an interesting topic of conversation. So, to get started, let me introduce our first member of the panel, Dr. Jeannie Becker, whose work illustrates the benefit of ISS research to space medicine. And we'll ask her to tell us about the exciting work to develop a vaccine for salmonella. Dr. Becker served as principal investigator for an experiment during Expedition 3 to the International Space Station that looked at 3D growth of human ovarian tumors in microgravity. In her current capacity as Chief Science Office of Astrogenetics, she is part of the research team developing a vaccine for Salmonella enterica. This initiative partners industry with academia and government for the development of a commercial product and serves as a pathfinder mission to validate the use of ISS as a national laboratory for commercial research and development after assembly is complete. Dr. Becker is Vice President and Institute Associate Director for the National Space Biomedical Research Institute. She is also an Associate Professor of Obstetrics and Gynecology and Surgery at the Baylor College of Medicine. Dr. Becker?
Thank you very much. This is very exciting for me to sit up here with my researcher hat on. Most of you all know me as an administrator, and I get the good fortune of overseeing a portfolio such as wonderful projects like Dr. Brainerd here. But today I'm going to tell you about how I spend my nights and weekends, and that is working on an industry project our initial product is to develop a vaccine for salmonella. And so for a lot of you, that probably seems like a big jump. And so let me give you a little bit of background. And the first thing I'd like to say is that this project really stemmed from some excellent fundamental science that was one of the lucky payloads that got to fly on shuttle. And that is that a couple of years ago, a finding was made that when you take a salmonella and you allow it to grow in space, that it becomes more virulent. And that was validated first by growing the organisms, bringing them back down, and injecting them into mice. And Dr. Cheryl Nickerson did that work and subsequently published that in PNAS. And it basically allowed the investigator community to kind of stand up and take notice of what the capability of microbes are in the environment of microgravity. A group of us got together and decided that if we could figure out the reason behind the increased virulence, that we could potentially create an attenuated vaccine, and that is to use the novel platform of microgravity to uncover what was involved in virulence, to target that, to potentially eliminate that target, and to then create a vaccine that could be used for on-Earth applications. So we really are using microgravity as a tool for new discovery. What we did is to enlist some excellent investigators in this field. The principal investigator on this work is Tim Hammond. We then sought Louis Stodiak and the BioServe group to provide hardware. They have some of the most experience of flying cell culture work, including plants, animal work, around in this country. And we found a commercial industry sponsor that was willing to step up to the plate and fund the work, and a small privately held venture called Astrogenetics was born. And Astrogenetics is a privately held portion of AstroTech, which is formerly known as SpaceHab. And so we put together our first payload last March, and what we did was to create several strains of knockouts of salmonella bacteria, and we brought in Alejandro Abele from Duke University, who is an expert in this field, and we set up a really interesting in situ or in microgravity virulence assay. So we knocked out certain genes that were known to affect virulence in the organism, and we used C. elegans, a small worm, as our a canary in the mine. And the worm will eat the worm eats bacteria as its normal food. It will eat salmonella, And if it eats salmonella that have increased virulence, it will kill the worm. And so right there you have your assay. It's a 48-hour assay, and it's contained in little canisters that have replicates of test tubes in them. And it's turned on by a simple crank of the crew. That is, the little can houses 8 test tubes, and the organisms are in each little compartment within the test tube. So one crank will mix the bacteria and the C. elegans together. They're allowed to hang out for 48 hours, and then an additional crank compresses it into the third compartment, which is a fixative, and the experiment's over and it's returned. And so basically we were incredibly smart, I will say. No, we were incredibly lucky that we nailed one of the genes on the first try. And subsequently now we have a target. When the gene was taken away, the bacteria, the virulence effect went away, and so that's what we're pursuing. And we've now flown 5 payloads, and we validated this. I'm very proud of the fact that we've flown 5 payloads in a little over a year and a half, which for those of you that are involved in space-based work know that's pretty amazing. And so we have formed a very serious effort to develop a vaccine. We're now going forward with developing investigational review board qualifications and putting together an investigational new drug IND application that'll be submitted to the FDA based on this work to go forward with phase 0 trials in humans, and that will be conducted at the VA at Duke Durham. So that's our first product in our pipeline. We've now increased the capabilities of the pipeline and of the company, and we just flew for our second time methicillin-resistant Staph aureus, as well as a host of other organisms that I wrote down here, but I can go into them later. Basically, they're very medically relevant nasty bugs that cause a lot of human disease. The goal for this work then is to use a similar approach with the other organisms to understand what is involved in increased virulence, and to use that knowledge as a target to create a therapeutic. That therapeutic might be a druggable target, or it might be a vaccine, as in the case of Salmonella. So I guess I'm probably nearing the end of my time. But what the main take-home message I would like to put forward is Station is a real platform for new discovery, and the case was made from some very good fundamental science that has now turned into a potential product and involved a company forming around it. So I think this really is an example, which is why we are a Pathfinder mission for validation of ISS National Lab for R&D, for commercial purposes, and for excellent, good science that potentially can turn into commercial products. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Becker. Fascinating. Next is Mr. Rob Benkowski. And Bob, if you want to, you can use this mic right here. That'll be all right. Bob's going to talk about the importance of technology transfer opportunities. He was instrumental in the development of the DeBakey ventricular assist device, which uses space shuttle technology to help pump blood through the body. The DeBakey pump is one of NASA's most successful technology transfer stories. Bob is COO of Micromed Cardiovascular, which manufactures the DeBakey device. Bob?
Thank you very much. I really appreciate being invited to such a distinguished panel and group of people. I'm going to let Dr. Noon get into some of the details of the DeBakey VAD, but keep my talk a little bit more on the spin-off opportunities of the space program. Ever since the Space Act of 1958, there's been an initiative to return to the public what was being developed for space, not only to help humanity, but also to gather the public support, which is crucial for the funding of the space program. You know, NASA doesn't want to be just another government agency. It wants to be the premier technology development agency and bring in that, what's discovered for space, in space, back down to Earth. So my background, as you mentioned, is with Micromed in engineering. I guess I'm one of the few crossovers that worked for the project office for the space station and now work for a commercial entity. And I just wanted to talk briefly about how this community can bring that technology to humanity through various, maybe in a broad spectrum of technology. So for example, on the DeBakey VAD, which Dr. Noon will show you later, that's really one of the high-end products that NASA has developed. And just to let you know, since commercializing that technology, Micromed has raised more than $110 million. We're still in, raising funds. And but at the other end of the extreme, in the NASA Spinoff magazine, which is one of the best magazines for promoting NASA technology, I noticed the most recent one. There is a single motion extension pole for a painting. You know, so there's a huge spectrum of technology that is developed for these space missions that can be commercialized and provide use right away. And in my experience, there's a little bit of a gap between what's invented for these space missions and the commercialization of it on Earth. I'll give you a few examples. I think some of the most famous NASA tagged products, Tang and Velcro, weren't actually developed by NASA, but at the same time have that the NASA name attached to them. And I think that NASA brand name still conjures up the ideas of high tech and space technology. A few other examples were NASA developed that have implications, broad implications on Earth, are Mylar cordless power tools, the switch for airbags in every car that you drive, the life shares, our blood pump, and another one, the 3D bioreactor. So, I think there's an opportunity for, as the new space programs are being developed, the rovers that are being developed that were discussed briefly yesterday, there should be an equal initiative to take what's learned from those and brought to today's everyday projects here on Earth. There's going to be advances in materials, manufacturing processes. There's going to be tremendous advantages in energy consumption, energy storage devices, and I'm looking forward to having those pushed through the tech transfer offices and brought to a commercialization. I think ours is a great success story. I think there's so many more opportunities that are missed their commercialization opportunity. Two primary reasons. One is I think we need to do a better job as a group to make that technology that's invented at NASA available. There's the Spinoff magazine. I don't know how many people have read it this month. That's one mechanism, but I think there's more efficient mechanisms to bring the technology to Earth. For example, just here in Houston, we have the Rice Alliance, we have the Houston Technology Center, and we also have the Bio Houston Group. They meet every month and discuss new technology. And being from the space program and now in the medical field, I listen to those and I think, wow, this would be good in space. Two good examples. Dr. Billy Cohn at Texas Heart Institute is developing a robotic ultrasound-driven catheter system. I think, wow, that would be great for somebody less skilled to be able to deliver a catheter, which may be necessary in space someday. Another one, there's another spin-off technology, OrthoExcel, which was made really to accelerate braces, but at the same time, I was thinking in the back of my mind, for long spaceflight programs, there may be some opportunity to make sure the astronauts have, good dental care and don't lose the bone mass in their teeth. The last thing astronauts want to do is come back and, have their teeth fall out or be subject to infections because they have teeth problems. So I guess my bottom line is I think that everybody should take the initiatives to, as you're developing projects for space, talk to your technology transfer office, see if this technology can be commercialized through your technology transfer office, and join some of the local groups, the local biotechnology groups to see if there's other technology that's being developed independently that you think can be brought in. And I think that sums up the my story here, and that is, you know, facilitate the technology transfer both from NASA and from the other space programs to commercialization, and look at what's being developed independently commercially and see if it can be brought into the space program. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Benkowski. Next, I'd like to introduce Dr. Bud Brainard to discuss insights from spacecraft lighting investigations and their applicability to commercial lighting technologies. Dr. Brainard is leading research into how light sources influence human hormones and behavior. He is a professor of neurology and pharmacology at Jefferson Medical College, directs the light research program at Jefferson, which is performing research into the regulation of melatonin, the influence of light on tumors, and testing new devices for winter depression. He can describe his commercial work with Philips. He has been part of an effort to design lighting for spacecraft through his research on the effects of long-term spaceflight on mood. Dr. Brainard?
Thank you. I'd like, in my few minutes, to describe what's a relatively rapid translation of basic science into applied science. And, of course, it's in the area that I work on, light and health. And the basic part of this is that the human eye contains two discrete sensory systems. And this is a relatively new discovery in the past 8 years. We all know light comes into the eye and allows us to see the world. That's the visual system. And if you can see the colors of the flags behind me, that's your three cones working together. And your peak sensitivity for that is at 555 nanometers, or what you would experience is yellow and green. For the biological and behavioral effects of light, the non-visual effects of light that largely take place below level of consciousness, a second sensory system is translating light, and its peak sensitivity is at around 480 nanometers, or in the blue part of the spectrum. And by and large, we're not aware of this, but the eye is a lot like the ear. It contains two complete sensory systems, and one is addressing consciousness, and the other is operating below the level of consciousness. And that fundamental biology really was discovered and elucidated between the years 2000 and 2008 by a variety of our laboratories, our own included and many others. And it was done with support from the National Space Biomedical Research Institute. So that's the basic science piece. Now, the space applications of this are that we would like to have a non-pharmacological intervention for disruption of sleep, disruption of circadian rhythms. We do have pharmacological agents that allow us to manipulate wakefulness and sleep. However, it would be nice to have something that didn't rely on pharmacology. As early as 1991, NASA instituted a pre-launch light countermeasure under the innovation of Dr. Seisler's group at Harvard, and that's been in operation since then. Last year, doing a test on the Phoenix lander ground crew, the Mars mission for Phoenix, Behavioral Health and Performance at JSC sponsored a test of using blue light, blue LED light, solid state light, as a non-pharmacological countermeasure. And the data from those projects, that project is being worked up right now. For that project, there was an industrial partner. Apollo Lighting in Utah provided the light units were used that the scientists and engineers in that project were exposed to. So we're very much looking forward to that data coming forward, and it was a combined industry and NASA project. Ultimately, we want an in-flight lighting countermeasure, something that can address the defined risk of human performance failure due to sleep and circadian disruption. Towards this end, we have a larger industrial partner, Philips Lighting, which is providing, has designed and created prototype lamps that are deeply enriched in the blue. They give a white appearing light, but a lot of energy in the blue range. And Philips has provided these to the program, sponsored by NSBRI. In addition, Apollo has provided not only the blue LED lights, but also white appearing LED lights that are deeply enriched in the blue as well. So studies are going on in laboratories looking at those new light sources. Now, a very exciting turn has happened in the past year. Kennedy Space Center, working with Bionetics under the leadership of Charles Schultz and Robert Soler, has developed the first prototype solid-state lamp, which has been taken out to space station, installed, and the astronauts have looked at it and found that the light coming from this solid-state source is acceptable for the purposes of stimulating vision. So ultimately, there is a move afoot to replace all of the lights on station with solid-state. And there's an advantage to that. And the advantage for NASA's purposes is it's less up mass, it consumes less energy, it produces less heat, and it has a longer lifespan. It has a tremendous bonus because station is currently illuminated by fluorescents, which contain the toxin mercury. So these would be non-toxic. So there are a lot of advantages towards moving in a solid state direction. Ultimately, Orion and Altair are looking at solid-state lighting for the future of all of those vehicles and those habitats. So that's the space application. Finally, the commercial application is shown in two places. When this new biology was elucidated, the first commercial entities that jumped on it were the light therapy companies that produced lighting units for people with winter depression and circadian disorders. And currently, these are small industries. Currently, they're selling something in multiple millions per year of this type of equipment. But many of them switched to blue-enriched products and or overtly blue products, and they've had a lot of commercial sales. The bigger industry really is general lighting. And if you just look around this room, every light source in this room is white appearing to your eye, it's incandescent, and it's fluorescent. Ultimately, you're looking at the dinosaurs of the lighting industry. Ultimately, at 10 to 20 years out, everything will be solid state. You won't have fluorescent bulbs or incandescent bulbs except for very small niche applications because this new technology is very versatile, very powerful, and there are a lot of attractive things, just as it's attractive for space flight. So we're looking at a revolution in both general lighting and architecture here on Earth. Companies that are large, like Philips, is investing in this, both for space applications, but also because it's going to have tremendous impact. It's going to be a multiple billion-dollar industry here on Earth. It'll first penetrate on operations that are continuous 24/7, like hospitals, military, manufacturing, homeland security, and so forth. But ultimately, it's going to penetrate all of lighting. So we have basically a merging of two themes. One is light has health impacts, operating below level of consciousness. Secondly, there's a new technology, solid-state technology, which will overtake all of the other previous existing lighting sources. So it's an exciting moment, and Space Station is going to be one of the lead installations in terms of this theme. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bernard. Next is Dr. George Noon to provide his perspective based on the use of circulatory assist devices in patient care. Dr. Noon is professor of surgery and chief of the Division of Transplant Surgery and Assist Devices in the Michael E. DeBakey Department of Surgery at Baylor College of Medicine in Houston. He is also executive director of the Multi-Organ Transplant Program at the Methodist Hospital and co-director of the Vascular Diagnostic Laboratory at Methodist. He has been a surgical partner for more than 40 years to Dr. DeBakey. His specialties include cardiac, thoracic, vascular, and general surgery, kidney, heart, and lung transplants, and the use of devices designed to help the heart pump more efficiently. Dr. Noon.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. I'd like to thank Mr. Abbey and Dr. Alford for inviting me to participate in this program. As he stated, my interests have been primarily in heart failure, treatment of heart failure surgically, and the development of assist devices and cardiac total heart replacements. And our story is sort of similar to the space in that we started in the mid-1960s when Dr. DeBakey was able to get NIH funding to develop research activities and support them for the development of total artificial heart. This then went on into the mid-1960s when we had our first implant, not of a total artificial heart, but a partial assist system in a patient who had unable to come off the heart-lung machine when she when we were finished with the operation. And so we supported her for about 7 days with a left ventricular assist device, which had been developed because of the total artificial heart program that we were working on. And then in the 1969, in that area, the first total artificial heart was implanted as what we call a bridge to transplant, and by Dr. Cooley, where he implanted this in one of his patients, and then a few days later, the heart was removed and the patient was transplanted. In the 1970s, we developed a heart program with the Russians, with Valery Shumakov, who is at the transplant and assist device head of that program in Moscow. And that was partially developed because of an operation that we had done on Professor Academician Keldysh with Dr. DeBakey. And then a few years after that, we were able to start this program up. Things as far as clinical application of the pumps was not very active in the 1970s, and it wasn't until the 1980s that pumps were utilized in specific protocols to be tested in humans, primarily as what we call a bridge to transplant, where the devices were used to bridge the patient until they could be transplanted and then removed. The devices that we were working on were primarily pulsatile devices. They were large and they were cumbersome, but they did serve the purpose. But we weren't supposed to do this, but I did it anyway. But this is one of the pulsatile devices that was approved for bridge to transplant. This is called the HeartMate 1. Well, after working with these devices for some time, we decided, this is sort of ridiculous in a way, and that we need something that's much smaller, because this is implanted totally in the body, but you can see how much space it takes. So we said what we need to do is go someplace where we can develop a smaller pump that could be used that would do the same thing. Well, to do that, we said, why to go any place except for NASA? They're right here in town, and they're the one that should have the expertise. And the things that we're looking for in the pump, for example, durability, reliability, size, power requirements, are all things that they're looking for their applications in the space. Also, in the pump, we didn't have to have valves, which we had to have for the pulsatile devices. And so we said, okay, we'll go to NASA. So how did we get out there? We had actually done a heart transplant on David Saucier, who is an engineer at NASA, and we called him up and said, David, this is what we want to do. And of course, David was very interested that we would get something going from his experience with heart failure. So he arranged for us to meet Dick Bozeman, Jim Ackerman, and Paul Zilkowski. And we went out there with all our devices and showed them to them, and they were very interested in trying to pursue something. And we said, we have some of the same problems that you have in space in developing these devices. They're not exactly the same, but we have hostile environments that we work in, and that hostile environment is the human body, and especially the blood, which is very fragile. We gave them the pump requirements that we would like for them to develop, which they were able to do without much problem. And then after they had been working on it for a while, of course this was on their own, they said, we think we have a pump that's going to be able to do the pumping without damaging red blood cells, because most of our testing as far as the pump characteristics were done in mock loops without blood. We put the blood in there, turned it on, and within 1 minute, every red cell was completely destroyed. And so they said, I guess there is something to the problems with blood. Well, they kept working on that and working on it, and we had iteration after iteration. After a while, we were getting sort of discouraged. I said, I don't understand. You guys put a man on the moon, and we're having so much trouble, with this pump. And they looked at me and said, I'll tell you what. They gave us a hell of a lot more money to put that man on the moon. So anyway, we kept working on the pump, and in 1998, this was 10 years after we first started the pump, we had finished our development, our trials with animals, and we were ready to go with implants in individuals or in people. And to do this, it was best for us. We got clearance to do it in Europe, and we started in November of 1998 rather, in Europe with implants in Berlin and then implant in Vienna, and that's where we started. And some of the things that we didn't know and which we were maybe possibly criticized about is another thing that's similar to space, in that no one knew what the long-term effects of no pulse would be. Up till now, I mean, every one of us in this room, our heart beats so many times per minute and it's always pulsatile. The other devices that we developed were all pulsatile, but this was a continuous flow pump which could possibly have some pulsatility, but it was just basically a continuous flow pump. We knew from some short-term experience that this would work for support of patients after cardiopulmonary or heart-lung machine bypass, but what it would do long-term, we had no idea. Well, our experience has been very positive in what it really does. It's able to support these patients. We're able to resuscitate patients with continuous flow. We're able to resuscitate them, rehabilitate them, and we actually get them back to normal activities. And the interesting thing is that this pulsatile pump was also used for what we call destination therapy, where it was put in patients to stay forever. Well, it worked very well for bridge to transplant, but when he went to destination therapy and it was in for longer than the 60 to 90 days it was for bridge to transplant, these pumps started falling apart about a year or year and a half and had to be replaced. Well, it got to the point when people are coming back for these to be replaced, they say, well, I don't want you to replace it with something, you know, the similar device. And so what we had to do then is go to the non-pulsatile continuous flow pump, and there's one that goes along with this called the HeartMate. So what we've seen now, we've seen patients who've been supported by pulsatile flow, we've seen patients who've been then switched over to continuous flow, and if you ask them what would you rather have if you were beginning from the very first time you had your implant, the continuous flow or the pulsatile flow, they always said we would rather have the continuous flow. For a variety of the size, it doesn't make any difference. These continuous flow pumps don't make any noise that the patient can hear. The pulsatile did. So you can sit in a room and you can close your eyes and you say, okay, here comes the NovaCore. It's a pulsatile pump. You know, here comes a Thoratec. Here comes a HeartMate. And the patient with the continuous flow pumps, you know, walks by and you say, I don't hear anything. And you don't. They don't make any noise. So it's much more patient friendly. The other thing is, as far as with the space industry, just recently, in fact this week, we had visitors from the Fuwai Hospital in China, in Beijing, who came to visit with us, and we started a program with them, and we'll be starting implants in China in the near future. And as far as Russia and our experience, we did do an implant in 2002 at the Bakalev Institute, so we've utilized this in Europe also, I mean in Russia and in the and so now what you can do is you can see this is a device we developed with our NASA engineers, which is totally implantable compared to this device that we were stuck with before we had this. So we're very pleased with what we were able to develop with NASA technology, and we are very also pleased that we were able to bring it to the patient population and be very successful in its use. Thank you.
That's fascinating. Thank you, Dr. Noon. Next is Dr. Neil Pellis, who will give us a NASA perspective on space life sciences and provide some thoughts on how countermeasures to the effects of space travel may have applicability to medical treatment of conditions on Earth, for example, bone loss management. He will also address his work with the bioreactor technology and how science done in space is used to inform design of bioreactor technology and research designs on Earth. Dr. Pellis is NASA's Senior Scientist for Space Life Sciences, headquartered at NASA's Johnson Space Center. Dr. Pellis oversees all of the medical, health, and biotechnology issues associated with human spaceflight, including research to counteract the effects of space travel. Dr. Pellis holds several adjunct appointments at the University of Texas and University of Houston. He has held a number of positions with NASA, including an assignment at NASA headquarters in Washington, D.C. Dr. Pellis?
Yeah, thank you. What I'm going to start with here is we're going to talk, I think, primarily about technologies that have been developed that are quite unique in many respects, and certainly unique because they emerged from a space program. And the first one that gets a lot of attention is a device that's sometimes called a space bioreactor. And it would be very easy for me to bring one to show you. But it would be not very exciting to see because it's just a horizontally rotating cylinder about the size of a Campbell's soup can. And so it's not nearly as exciting as what Dr. Noonan can show you as far as the visual effects. So I'm going to try to tell you a little bit about it and tell you why we think that it's got a lot to offer and where it's gone since its inception. It was conceived somewhere in the late 70s that there ought to be something in the way of some kind of a system to keep cells in suspension so that we could do cell biology experiments in space and keep them in suspension until you get through the launch profile. And out of that grew a number of different devices, a lot of which are really just paper on a shelf and numbers for patents. And so I won't talk too much about those. But that resulted in this one system, the horizontally rotating cylinder that I spoke to you about. And the unique aspect of that cylinder is when it's completely filled with water, it behaves very differently than you might expect. Particles, cells, whatever you want to say, that are slightly more dense than water, when this rotates slowly, become suspended. And they remain suspended. And interestingly, if you could ride one of those particles, you'd find out that you're actually falling at terminal velocity in that fluid for most of the time you're in that rotational paradigm. And that gave them the system that could actually meet some of the requirements that they were talking about. The unexpected side of that history is that it really resulted in a technological development that gave us a lot of advantages. We wanted to study cells in space, and the reason for that is that cells, just like they are for biomedical research on the ground here, are models for many different kinds of systems in the body, models for disease and whatever. So that was the first reason. And the second is I think that we try to understand how terrestrial life adapts to the microgravity environment, to the radiation that's there, the whole space experience. Some of this can be done at the cellular level, and some things that may not even be quite as ethical in human beings, we can do to cells. We can put them in a radiation beam. We can do all kinds of nasty things to them and watch how they behave and how they respond to it. So that's the reason for doing it. The one thing that we had to do is be able to take the technology that we, as we understood it on the ground, and begin to translate that into what goes on in space, and also translate it into equipment that we can use in space in parallel. And we did develop a system that is actually a space-designed bioreactor system, which has its own, pulsatile heart. It has a lung system for it to be able to get good gas transfer, so we can keep cells alive and functioning a long time in that system. So let's talk first, about the outcomes of what we saw with the ground-based development of the technology. The first thing that we found is that it allows the cells to die. That was the first thing. The surprising thing is a lot of cells that we grow from the human body are what we call anchorage dependent. They like to hang on to something. There are some that aren't, but the greater preponderance of them are, and they don't die. And in fact, what they do is they get together with each other, since they can't stick to plastic or something, and things happen after that. So it became a very good system for that, but also we discovered that things that we observed in this system had parallels of what we were observing in cell culture in space. So it became a cell culture analog system. This is extremely valuable in designing experiments for space study. And you can refine experiments much, much more readily using a good analog system and do a much better experiment in space. I'll give you an example of that in a few minutes. So the outcomes of that ground-based study with a myriad of different kinds of cells, probably over 70 different kinds of cells have been grown in this thing. So we want to talk about specifics. You can ask me about specifics, and hopefully I can give you some answers to that. But it became a platform for understanding a number of factors, one of which is that physical forces do, in fact, impact life systems all the way from bacteria to us. And previously, we didn't think bacteria and cells were that impacted because gravity, in fact, is a fairly insignificant force as far as the strength of the force when you compare it to other things that are going on, intermolecular attractions and Brownian movement, the impact of molecules, much more you think, influential on cell-sized devices, particles and things. So it allows us a platform to do that. And the value came out on the ground-based side when we realized that tissues or cells, when they reassemble, begin to morph back into a lot of the morphology they had as an existing tissue before they had been dissociated. And so it became a tool in tissue morphogenesis. And the tissue morphogenesis work that's done is done basically for three reasons. Obviously, can you make models of human disease? And secondly, can we make models that we can use in drug testing venues? Can we make more robust models that will allow us to understand better how two different types of tissues interface with each other? For instance, in neoplastic disease, as tumors progress and metastasize, there's a participation from the normal cell component. And so it gave us a platform in which to be able to do that. Can you make tissues for transplantation? I think that there's a possibility. I'm not putting that anywhere on the horizon or on a timeline for you. But obviously, if you can conduct fairly high fidelity tissue morphogenesis, there's the opportunity to do that. And the folks who are working type 1 diabetes have had an interest in this as a possibility to make islet cell assemblies with other participating cells to be able to implant into type 1 diabetic kids. The technology itself ended up being transferred out as a company, Synthicon Incorporated, manufactures this device. There, as of January of 2008, there were more than 25,000 units sold worldwide. And so, and obviously NASA owns about 30 of those, so we don't, we're not the customer here. It's actually the scientific community outside who've realized now what the potential is for this kind of technology and what you might be able to do. And in fact, I could extend it one step further. Dr. Becker told you about what they've observed in some of the bacteria. The initial observations that suggested that that might happen in space were actually conducted in this rotating analog system. So I think you can see there's a fair breadth of opportunities here. As of today, there's more than 200 primary publications in peer-reviewed journals on this subject. You can run it up on PubMed or your favorite search service, and you'll find that there's quite a robust portfolio of papers there. There's about 30 patents within NASA on that. There's probably at least an equal number on the outside for various adaptations of the technology. It's had a good ride, so to speak, and I think the ride is actually just beginning. I think we'll see another good 10 or 15 years before it's supplanted by some other super technology. So what we know from this is that we get pictures of changes in gene expression that might occur in space, and we've seen some things matched in microgravity, like cellular locomotion is lost in this device, and it's also as well lost in microgravity. Their ability to walk in space is not nearly as good as ours, despite the suits that we have. So with that, I'd like to close and say thank you very much for your interest in this, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pellis. We'll have, I think, adequate time for questions after the panel. It looks like we're doing well on time. Next at the table is Dr. Babs Soler, who's going to share with us her experiences working to found a company for commercial sales of a medical device she developed. She has an interesting perspective on how the requirements of the space environment improve technology. Funded by the National Space Biomedical Research Institute, Dr. Soler is developing a portable, non-invasive device to measure the effectiveness of exercise and other countermeasures to muscle atrophy in space. The device also has potential applications for emergency medicine, care of critically ill patients, and on the battlefield. Dr. Soler is professor of anesthesiology at the University of Massachusetts Medical School, where she develops medical applications of near-infrared spectroscopy.
Thank you. Pleasure to be here this morning with you. I'm also privileged to be the team leader for the National Space Biomedical Research Institute Smart Medical Systems team, which is a group of 8 university investigators who are developing medical technology that's required for long-duration spaceflight. We heard yesterday that there's a need to have more medical data in flight, not just the ability to assess medical conditions or before flight and after flight, but the need to be able to get medical data and get scientific data while the astronauts are in space. And this is exactly the problem that the members of the Smart Medical team are addressing in their technology development. As a team, we're each developing unique technologies that are non-invasive, easy to use by being highly automated. They provide continuous real-time information on a number of important medical parameters. So they'll provide medical as well as scientific data for use by the astronauts and the flight surgeons. One of the things that's very unique about our group is that 50% of the investigators are co-funded by the DOD, and 75% of our investigators have ties to industry. And this provides significant benefits in that the technology that we're developing is specifically addressing both the needs of the military as well as the needs of NASA. And as such, we're also able to bring advanced technology to remote areas of the U.S. as well as the rest of the world, and we're able to bring advanced technologies for trauma care out of the hospital and into ambulances where they're more likely to save lives and reduce complications. One thing about developing new medical technologies is that it requires a lot of money. It requires, as we've heard from a number of the panelists, engineering expertise, scientific expertise, and then it requires clinical trials in order to gain regulatory approval. The military in particular will not allow new devices to be used for in the military near the battlefield unless regulatory approval is received from the FDA. And one of the things I'd be interested in hearing from the audience is NASA's perspective on regulatory approvals, and in particular the international agency's perspective on regulatory approvals for new medical devices. But one of the dilemmas we all face in developing this technology is getting that money that is required to bring this technology out of our research labs and for use by not only NASA but the civilian population. And of course, this money you would hope would be available from the industrial sector. But in the medical device business, what we find is that medical device companies do not invest in university technologies. They rarely license patents out of universities. Instead, they like to buy companies, and they like to buy successful companies. So really the only way to get that funding from industry is to be able to start a company, raise the money to get a product onto the market. So I have been spending the last year of my life in the evening and weekends as Dr. Becker trying to raise venture capital for my company. And raising venture capital money is a very competitive process. The venture capital investor that I've been working with tells me that they see 5 to 8 proposals a day. And over the year, they're going to invest in 6 companies. So it's actually harder to raise venture capital money than to get money from the NIH. So you have to be very unique. You have to have a product that has a large commercial potential in order to get their attention. And one of the things I discovered in my year-long quest for raising money for my company was that the requirements to build a non-invasive sensor that will meet the space program's need for use in a spacesuit, which is what I'm addressing, which is a sensor to measure metabolic rate on the surface of the moon during lunar EVA. Those requirements, which we're building into our product now in order to facilitate testing with Mike Gernhardt's group, have allowed us to produce a very exciting product. This product will be inexpensive to manufacture, which means high cost margins for the company, but it'll be very robust, and it will use very little power. So the requirements of small size, lightweight, low power translate into a very attractive medical product, and one that has very good economic return for the investors. To give you an idea of the type of money that's required, I'm extremely grateful for the support that I've received from the National Space Biomedical Research Institute and the military. However, it requires twice that total funding in order to get this product to market. The good news in that is that when I do get that funding and we do get the product to market, that's a 4x return to NSBRI in their investment in this technology. And what they get in return and what NASA gets in return is a validated product and also one that has a significant impact for people here on Earth. While this is very exciting for me, it's also been very difficult. And some of the things that I think probably this community as a whole needs to address is working with all the entities involved. This is a wonderful academic, federal government, industry partnership. But from the academic perspective, most academic institutions are not well versed in technology transfer to all industries, and in particular, there's little knowledge of the medical device industry. And so technology transfer transactions that understand and respect the economics of medical devices are difficult. There's also a tremendous issue around conflict of interest at all levels, and again, something else that probably needs to be addressed. But I think this is a great model for developing medical technology that has applicability in space, as well as for the military and for the civilian population on Earth. And I can tell you that three other members of our Smart Medical Systems teams have also started companies. And I think it's a great testament to the National Space Biomedical Research Institute for supporting these projects at their critical time where they can attract significant funding from the investment community. So I'd like to thank the audience, and I'd be happy to answer questions later.
Thank you, Dr. Soler. Appreciate the information very much. Next is Captain U.S. Navy retired Ken Reitler. Ken is a former NASA astronaut who piloted two space shuttle missions, STS-48, which launched the Upper Atmospheric Research Satellite to provide scientists with complete research data on the upper atmosphere, and on STS-60, which was the first flight of the Wake Shield facility that came out of Rice here and Dr. Ignatiev. Captain Reitler is now the Vice President for NASA Program Integration for Lockheed Martin, which is developing the Orion crew capsule for the Next Generation Constellation program. Ken?
Well, thank you, Brewster, and good morning. Dobre utro. It's nice to be with you all. I really appreciate the invitation to be here at the summit, but also to be part of this panel, which I think is very fascinating subject to deal into. I guess I am representing the large industry partner perspective. And I'd like to share with you a little bit of what I think where we're going with industry partnerships. But also before I do that, really kind of want to give you a little bit of kind of the background of what has shaped and formed some of those perspectives. As Brewster said, I had two opportunities to be on a crew of the space shuttle, two very different missions. And those missions included some things which to me really demonstrated the value of having a vehicle, a transportation system, which is incredibly flexible and very capable. Shuttle has been able to do a lot of things which I think its original designers hadn't really thought about and really hadn't planned for to do. First of all, mission to planet Earth was really the precursor for where we are today with our Earth resources missions and our Earth science activities. We really hadn't thought about using that as a vehicle to do that particular mission, but it worked out to be, quite spectacular. Secondly, was to do things which were more on a commercial basis. We've heard a lot of mention of SpaceAb. This was the second flight of SpaceAb, and so it really introduced to me kind of the, you know, this whole world of doing things on a commercial basis. It also pointed out some of the problems associated with doing commercial government activities when really the only customer is the government. And I think that's really presented ongoing set of challenges with regard to commercial space. And then lastly, of course, the Wake Shield facility, which was really a tremendous example of how you can combine the strength of academia with industry and the government together to exploit a really kind of different, unique aspect of being in space. We really utilize macrogravity to do a lot of different things. We've heard some examples today of some really astounding kinds of results we've gotten from the microgravity environment, but we really hadn't tried to use the low pressure, the vacuum of space. And so this was kind of yet another exploitation of the space environment. And finally, also demonstrated to me the value of international cooperation and working together with many different countries, particularly in this case, STS-60 was the first U.S.-Russian joint mission. It really kind of set the stage for a lot of the things that we did to follow that on Mir, and of course how we then decided to work on the International Space Station together. And it really, to me, brought forward the real value of the political uses of space, but also the international cooperation of space. After my time on the space shuttle, I was asked to do a number of management jobs, both that took me from the Launch Control Center environment and the Mission Control Center environment, and finally running the Space Station branch, which at that time included also our work on Mir. And again, allowed me to kind of see how a new spacecraft, a new system was going to be developed, to be put together, and the value of those relationships that we had built on STS-60 with the crew members as well as the Russian managers to be able to pull this whole thing together. After leaving NASA, I joined Lockheed Martin, where I was a program manager for several large programs. One of those was the engineering prime contract at the Johnson Space Center. And in working those activities, we touched on a lot of the things that we heard today. Over 10 years ago, we designed, built, and tested some solid-state lights, for example, that would replace lights on the shuttle and the station. Subsequently, were not accepted because of just a cost savings, but in fact now, as we see, there are other values in addition to reliability and cost that touch on the human side. Those rationale, those justifications kind of carry the day. Also did a lot of science work. We were mission managers for a lot of the space life science space lab missions, including Neuralab, but also in space and life sciences. We had one of the three papers on life inside the Martian meteorite. It was one of our employees. So we really touched across a lot of different space, life, and earth sciences, as well as operations. We designed and built the Mission Control Center in Houston and continue to operate that. I then became the president of our services company, a company that's providing technical services to NASA predominantly, although also NOAA. Both in the engineering, science, and operations world. And then finally, with the win of Orion, I transitioned from the services part of the business over to the development. So I really have an industry perspective, both from large-scale development as well as technical services. How do you do business with NASA? That's when you talk about industry, that's really what it's all about. How do you turn a relationship, an activity with a government agency into a money-making proposition? And there are a couple of things I'd like just to talk about there. First is that services is really getting very hard for big businesses to do. First, there is a very aggressive socioeconomic goal process that NASA is undertaking. Secondly, there's an organizational conflict of interest. Dr. Soler talked about conflict of interest. That's something that we need to continuously deal with. How do you provide the services, operational or technical services, on a vehicle that you're also designing and building? So from that perspective, organizational conflict of interest is something we really have to deal with a lot. There's also, I think, the issue of constant competition, turnover or churn, as we tend to call it in the business. With Jim Voss and I were talking about the issues that are associated with turnovers of company and dealing with the cultures that are associated with companies and making those changes from one to the other. There is a significant impact, I think, to the workforce in doing that. Next, the United States government is really looking very hard at the whole issue of large-scale systems integration. And, you know, when the chief executive officer of the United States, the president, commander-in-chief, points to one of your programs that's a large-scale integration program and points to it as an example of a process run amok, you know it's going to be a bad day. So there is a very great trend to move away from that process of the government to having more government involvement with systems integration. But I would say that our past history is that the government doesn't necessarily do any better a job at that. Third, I think the U.S. government is also tempted to try to fix some of the problems that they've seen in that process with going to a fixed-price contract relationship. In our looking at that, in terms of if you're going to try to fix the problem of cost and schedule with a fixed-price contract, you're probably approaching the problem from the wrong perspective. The problem really is driven by the requirements process and the requirements creep process, not really knowing what you want to build when you let the contract to begin with. And so if that's the problem that you're trying to solve, the industry's response to that will be to protect itself and to make sure that they manage the risk associated with those unknowns. And so the resulting of that will be that the cost goes up even higher, and it really won't solve the initial problem that you really tried to fix, and that was trying to identify a process or a program that solves an unknown problem. So to me, that's really presenting some really interesting problems, but it's really not getting us any closer to the final solution. Next, NASA is really strategically trying to rebuild its technical capability. And in doing so, and manage programs to accomplish that, the result is that these programs are less efficient. They are taking longer. They're stretching out the timelines and the budgets. But again, if it's like Brewster always says, what is it you're trying to fix? What is it you're trying to solve? And if you're trying to solve a technical capability problem, then it's probably worth it. If you're trying to run programs more efficiently and produce hardware faster, it's probably not going to solve that problem at all. I think the United States is still pushing very hard on that holy grail of cheaper access to space. But right now, I think we are not yet to the point where we're able to solve that problem very, very quickly, or certainly in time to be able to provide some of the services that we would hope to accomplish through that means. Again, you know, when we have a commercial approach to doing business and yet the only customer is the United States government, I question how truly commercial, you know, that process or that result is. I think right now the United States government and many of the other governments that I've worked with are really trying to work to more of a collaborative process. You know, the classic approach to building hardware where the government decides what they want, they issue an RFP, industry designs the system to meet all the requirements in the RFP, the government awards that contract, and the company goes off and builds it, and X months later they turn it over to the government and the government goes off and uses it, really never worked. I mean, it never was truly there. It never really happened that way, even though that's in many of the textbooks that I see still show that's the way things work. And I don't think it really ever will. There really truly needs to be much more of a collaborative venture. And I think that for example, in Orion, we're working that way very closely with the government today. But some of the things which really have a way of impacting that collaborative nature and that ability for industry to engage with government are all of the starts and the stops in terms of the process, in terms of the design. You know, I've heard it said, I spend a lot of time in Washington. It's really nice to be in Houston and away from that environment today. But in Washington, we hear a lot about, you know, if it's really change you can believe in, the change would be that we actually do what we say we're going to go do. You know, we actually implement the program and execute it and get to the end instead of starting it and stopping it. That really is a very difficult issue. It really feeds into a lot of the transition problems that we're facing today with shuttle and the workforce impacts. It talks to, of course, the budget and the budget cuts and the kinds of impacts that have on industrial workforce. Because when we're working with the government has as Mike Coates defined it the other day, they have a ceiling of a certain number and they have a floor of a certain number and those numbers are the same. Chances are that any, you know, any change to the program is going to be taken by the contractors. And so in our case, for example, a good example of that was when NASA cut back the budget for the non-human life sciences work that we had out at NASA Ames. Those programs continued on at a much, much lower population, animal and plant life research is what I'm talking about. And where the cuts came were in our workforce, in the Lockheed Martin workforce. And our response to that was to find jobs, and we had an easy job because these were very highly skilled, very capable scientists and engineers in other parts of our business, particularly since we have a large facility at Sunnyvale, which is across the runway from NASA Ames. But the result is that those people are now gone. And the long experience they have in working in plant and animal research is now gone. And those when the funding comes back someday, which I certainly hope it will, those people won't come back because they're doing other jobs that are very satisfying in other parts of our industry, but their expertise won't return. So I think as an industry, we've certainly got some interesting opportunities, and certainly as I said with Orion, I'm trying to take all of the things that I'm hearing at this summit, all the good experiences that you all are sharing about the importance of how we operate humans in space, and make sure that we're applying those to the design and operation of Orion, but also the fact that it's a very, very important aspect to make sure that you try to do whatever you can in the next generation of spacecraft, as we did with Shuttle, to have a flexible vehicle that can do more than what we're just thinking about it today. And as it turns out with Orion, when you design a spacecraft to meet the requirements to go to the moon, anywhere on the moon, and come back anytime from any place on the moon, the result is an incredibly capable spacecraft for low Earth orbit. And we're spending a lot of our investment money looking at other missions that Orion can do to support science, to support other parts of the aerospace industry, small sats, et cetera, even to the point of doing the kind of work we're doing today on the Hubble Space Telescope, perhaps with satellite servicing. So this is an opportunity for us to make sure that we get it right and do the things necessary to make Orion as capable and as flexible as Shuttle has been in the past. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much, Ken. And our last panelist this morning is Dr. James Tour, who we've heard from earlier today regarding his work on radiation protection. On this panel, I hope to hear his perspective on evolving export regulations, where he has insight based upon his role on the Department of Commerce Export Control Committee. Dr. Tour is a synthetic organic chemist and an expert in nanotechnology on the faculty of Rice University. His research interests include molecular electronics and nanotubes for health applications. He won a Space Act Award from NASA for his development of carbon nanotube reinforced elastomers. Dr. Tour is also an innovator in K-12 education, having developed the Nano Kids program that uses the popular video games Dance, Dance Revolution, and Guitar Hero to teach children about nanotechnology.
Thank you. Privyet, ni hao, welcome to Rice. This is to give an overview of some of the work that I've been doing serving on the Department of Commerce Emerging Technology Board, and it's to revise our current laws. There was a real frustration when Rice brought in a team of attorneys from the outside to assess what the laws are and try to become in compliance. And it caused a lot of grief, and there was a lot of outcry from a number of institutions because it was really going to hamstring the work that we were trying to do. What I want to do is read you what the deemed export requirement means. It's not giving something to somebody, it's telling somebody something. And this is what we do in the university all the time. And of particular concern to them are people from certain countries. And to be specific, some of the countries that are at the top of the list are Russia and China. What is communicated? And if we go by the rules, there may be assessed to be many violations that took place in this meeting over the last day and a half. So let me read you this rule, and then I'll fill it in and show you what the problem is and why we need some rules changed here. Deemed export means release or transfer of technology that has dual use to a foreign national in the U.S. So now let me fill that in. Release or transfer, that's like a professor instructing a student. Of technology, it means know-how, not a physical thing other than source code, but it means just know-how that has dual use, military and civilian, to a foreign national that does not include a green card holder who happens to be in the United States. So what I teach to my Chinese students or to my Russian students that is not already in the literature in print is deemed a deemed export, and that is illegal. That's why we need some laws changed. So I'm sitting on this committee, and we've been given what's called a zero base means. That means we don't start with the existing law and try to modify it. We start with a clean slate and say, how do the laws have to change? Because personally, I think the deemed export control law is absolutely ridiculous in an academic setting, for sure, and could be ridiculous in many industrial settings as well. Let me read you some facts that have taken place since this deemed export law has come into effect, which has been in effect for about a decade. 99% of the exclusions, meaning when a company has written and said, can we be excluded from this regulation in this case, 99% of the exclusion requests for deemed export control have been granted of the tens of thousands of requested. The 0.5% not granted were almost always granted after there was a small clarification. 60% of the deemed export control licenses have been requested by just four companies in the United States. That means probably Lockheed and Boeing are very good at doing this sort of thing, and nobody else is doing this.
We try.
And 0% of the deemed export control licenses have been requested by universities. Zero. So when I tried to push this a little bit with the representative from the Department of Commerce, and I said to her, so why do you figure no universities have requested this? She said, I assume they're all in compliance. And I told her she's extremely optimistic. In the past 5 years, there's been 120 cases of deemed export control violations that have been checked by the Department of Commerce Enforcement Office. Of those 120, 19 people, and that's 17 cases, were noted for penalties, and several others led to letters of warning, but no penalty. The average penalty was about $20,000. One of the cases was $800,000 and a 2-year prison term, but that was particularly egregious. None others had prison time. None of the 17 was a university, but two of the 120 that were originally screened were universities. Universities would have a particularly hard time to be convicted due to what's called a basic research exclusion. But I'll show you the problems of that. So if anybody really reads these laws as say, an academic would, and tries to make sense of this, there's real problems. Does this expensive machine of the Deemed Export Control Office, does this expensive machine warrant continuation when few cases of technology transferred were the few cases of technology that was transferred were far less damaging to the U.S. economy than the restriction of free flow? So remember, the Department of Commerce's view is we're losing technology. You tell this international student, they go away, they go to their own country, they develop it, and then they clean our clock when it comes to development of the technology. My feeling about this is, if my student can take something that I've told him or her and go back to their home country and start an operation and beat me out on it, God bless them. Let them do it. It means that we haven't been as innovative, we haven't been as entrepreneurial, and we haven't done this. Let it at least be developed. Moreover, of the 33 nation members, the Vassanar nations who work with the U.S. to coordinate export control, none have deemed export control laws, only the United States. And remember, of the tens of thousands of licenses requesting for deemed export exclusion, law exclusion, almost 99%, in fact, greater than 99% were granted. So why have this idiotic system in place? I thought that at Rice we could mitigate all the problems by at least having our postdocs come under the shelter of a class. But then this research exclusion is also a problem. The problem is this: the Department of State, that's ITAR restrictions, the Department of State differs with the Department of Commerce on what a research exclusion is. The Department of State says if it is published, then it's excluded from restrictions. The Department of Commerce says that their interpretation is if the intent is to publish. You see the difference, published versus the intent to publish. My argument is, look, most of the time I'm not looking through the microscope anyway. It's the student. They teach me. They said, that's fine. They can teach you anything they want. That's fine. No law against that. But I can't teach them anything. So I could be taught by a Russian student, but not tell the other Russian student about it. This is how silly the laws are. Let me give you some silliness in the interpretation of why things are put on the list for restriction. For example, we make carbon nanotubes at Rice. It's one of the things that we developed, the large-scale processes. They've been commercialized. They're now commercialized all over the world. They're made in Russia. They're made in China. In fact, we had developed a procedure back in the early 90s for making C60. And we said in the patent that it would lower the cost by at least two orders of magnitude. Lo and behold, 6 months after we filed the patent and wrote the publication, I was approached by a Russian company wanting to sell me C60 at a very low cost. And they could sell it to me actually cheaper than I could make it myself in my own lab. And I remember the man's name. He was a representative from Russia. And I said, Michael, are you using my process to sell me back the very things that I have patented? And he said to me, you know, Jim, my English is not so good. But I was really quite impressed that they could take this and do it and exploit it and use it. For example, they say a carbon nanotube is on the list. My argument is they're made all over the world anyway. I can't ship it to my colleague. I can't even ship it to a colleague in the United States who's not a green card holder, even though he or she may be a professor. I can't do that. And the reason is carbon nanotubes are put on the list because they say that they have a very strong modulus, a stiffness, higher than any carbon fiber. But I say that's as a single molecule. You want to try to bend a benzene ring and tell me how stiff that is? You can't say a single molecule is a fiber. The other thing is, did you know that red wine would be considered on the list? Because there's a law that says you cannot sell a material, and it's because of laser dyes. You cannot sell a material that is not transparent in the visible, doesn't define the intensity of transparency or not. There's no extinction coefficient here. Any material not transparent in the visible that also absorbs between 800 and 2,000 nanometers, again, no absorption coefficient, is covered by this ruling. Wine is not transparent, meaning it absorbs in the visible. That's why it's red. It also has hydroxy groups, water, in it, so it will have hydroxy overtones in the near IR. Wine would be restricted if we were to observe the rules in totality from being able to share this with a foreign national in the U.S. or to export it. These laws are really ridiculous, and it's part of some academics that are on the committee that are really pushing to try to get this changed and to come up with an algorithm with new technologies to put it through this algorithm to see should it really be protected or could it make our lives a lot easier by having many of these things taken off the ITAR list and the deemed export control list. Because we have to have good free exchange of knowledge, and without this, and particularly in an academic environment, we're going to hamper ourselves tremendously. And so we'll go through, come up with this algorithm, and then we want every 2 years for things to have to go back through this process to see should they still be protected or are they now ubiquitous. And these are some of the things that need to be covered to make sure that we're able to keep this free flow of information going and lower some of the barriers, because it's actually hurting our economy and not helping it.
We feel your pain. We do feel your pain. Both the space shuttle and the space station are declared defense articles, therefore under auspices of the Department of State and ITAR. And we, in Boeing, train 160,000 people or so every year on computer-based training for more than an hour on export compliance. It is a very hot topic. No matter how much we train, every once in a while we have to go self-declare and say, you know, beg forgiveness because we screwed up and we clean it up. Share your pain. I'm sure Ken can relate similar experiences. Thank you very much. Okay, now we are to the point where we're open for questions on any of the subjects to any of the speakers. And I think there are microphones that will be made available.
A couple of comments about the LED lights and a question to Dr. Perez. The question about comments about the LED light is that because the white LED light, I'm Kaz Shimada from Japanese Space Agency in JAXA, and because the white LED light was invented in Japan, we are much for, you know, told that. But as the commercial opportunity, we failed to retain Dr. Nakamura, who is right now in California. And the LED lights on the ISS will begin on the our HTV vehicle, which is the H2B transfer vehicle. And that vehicle will have the LED packs. And they are talking about leaving those lights on the ISS. And the other topic is about the photochemical reactions. And there are some commercial materials. Some are used as a paint over the outside of the buildings to clean the air. And they automatically cleans the building itself. And the technology came to the point that not only the ultraviolets, but also the visible light could be used for that self-cleaning and decontamination. So we might be able to apply that technique on ISS because it's a closed environment, has the much trouble in cleaning up the air. And although the ISS doesn't have a planned mechanism to collect the sunlight, there's an abundance of sunlight pouring onto the ISS, and we are going to, you know, launch the cupola. So there might be a opportunity for using it. And the question for Dr. Perez is that about the tissue morphogenesis, since the commencement of the the experiments on using the Japanese model. There was an experiment done on the gene level, a DOM gene. And the bioreactors had such, you know, draw such attentions. But we hear that now you have a problem of logistics. The question is, do you think the it should be going to the onboard you know, analysis, which obviously have much technical issues, or should we develop some timely small sample recovery vehicle for a timely recovery of the you know, live samples?
Shall I start?
You can if you want.
Okay. Well, certainly I would agree with you. Japan has been a pioneer in the solid-state lighting industry, and many nations, China and Europe, U.S., have similarly invested heavily now in this technology, and the innovations are coming very fast, and they're predicted to continue to become fast. What we see is LED, that form of solid-state lighting, is just one form of solid-state. There are going to be films, paints, materials. There'll be things that we can't even begin to guess at. And these will all find applications in the space program. So absolutely, I agree with you about Japanese leadership in this. And I think it's going to benefit not only the space program, but very, very broadly the domestic programs all over the world. So,
yes, as far as having modular and multi capabilities with bioreactors, there's been a number of things that have been spoken and discussed about that. There is no design at hand right now. I think that's what you were saying, one of the things. Secondly is that I know that Japan has developed two-axis and three-axis rotational paradigms to be used for trying to mitigate some of the non-parity things that we see in this rotational paradigm on the ground in one axis and what goes on in space. And the last part of the question was on how to get things back, I believe is what you were saying. It's not your problem. I have a hearing problem, and it's particularly bad today for some reason. But and getting things back, and you have a choice here, and I think we have to look at this as a community now. We're either going to bring specimens back for analysis, and we have the capability for freezing things, we can fix things, we can hold them for a while, but the question is getting them a ride back. There hasn't been any talk, to my knowledge, in the NASA side of this about having something to bring back specimens. The commercial guys discuss this from time to time, the various companies that are developing commercial flight vehicles. But I've not seen anything that's come out, and I just may be totally ignorant on that. The alternative to those venues is to have in situ analytical equipment. And it's a whole lot cheaper to send back ones and zeros than it is to send back big chunks of meat that we might want to grow up there and bring back and think we can analyze. And so, you know, if we could be better with the requirements of what's necessary in the way of analytical capacity, and does it meet the you know, size and power and all of that other stuff that we always are worried about in the space program, I think that's really the way to go. I don't know if it can be implemented because it's going to be critically dependent on transportation up as well. So I don't have a good answer for you. I got good ideas, but no money. So
one aspect is that the people are all the agencies are looking at the big return capability, almost like you know, returning a Progress or ATV or HTV. But I personally think why don't they you know think about the small vehicle, maybe just a return of the 1 kilogram of a sample or 3 kilograms of a sample, because samples are not humans. It could be a return you know piece by piece, and even though the recovery rate, success rate could be somewhere like 70%.
Inessa spoke about the Bion, and there is also a small sat program that's out that has these small packages which are so totally autonomous and which you can put small experiments in that are living systems, and they have the integrated analytical system along with it, and they also have, in addition to that, the capacity to recover it.
Oh, okay. I'm talking about this. Why not, you know, make a, you know, return small vehicle from ISS? Because we have a, you know, small airlock which has a manipulator, so we can jettison something.
You need a higher pay grade person to answer that question. I hate to be Dutch. In fact, you know, I don't see one here that's it's hiding back. We'll ask Charlie Bolden in next year.
There,
give him a chance.
To follow on to that comment, there are capabilities in development that are perhaps not widely well known, and I know that Spacehab has a vehicle like that, for example, that I'm familiar with. So I think that possibly as commercial development matures in the commercial space arena, that more of these types of capabilities will come online. And I know just from talks I've had with various people that, in fact, that train of thought is being entertained very strongly right now.
Okay, we have a question back here.
Thank you. I have questions for Dr. Noon and Dr. Soller, if that's okay.
Speak up, please.
Oh, I'm sorry. So, Dr. Noon, I just wanted to ask about, I'm trying to understand the relationship between the NASA engineers and DeBakey Institute. And am I correct in understanding that non-pulsatile LVADs didn't exist before that interaction and the Archimedes screw concept didn't exist before that? And is it correct to say that it wouldn't have existed or would have taken a long time to exist if that interaction hadn't occurred? So that would be my question to Dr. Noon. And my question to Dr. Soller is, as a clinician trying to be involved in startup businesses, at the same time trying to demonstrate the clinical effectiveness of your device, how do you box around those conflict of interest problems at publication? So those are my questions.
Let me start. I can start. As far as the continuous flow pumps, of course, Archimedes was a long time ago, so that goes back a lot further than anybody in this room. But as far as the use clinically, what we had used for continuous flow was both a roller pump and a centrifugal pump for cardiopulmonary bypass, primarily. So those were durations of 1 to 2 hours, maybe 4 or 5 hours. And we had, with the patients who were unable to be weaned from bypass, we would support them for periods up to 2 weeks with continuous flow pumps. But that is for the furthest that we'd gone. So we knew up to 2 weeks, provided other systems were working okay, that we could support patients adequately with continuous flow pumps. And most of those patients were then weaned off. But as far as long-term, there was really no experience in that. There was some long-term experience, well, 90 days or so in animals, which suggested that there were some changes in as far as the cardiac output should be about 20% what it is in the normal animal. Well, we found out in patients that that's not necessary. In fact, we could throw cardiac outputs less than the normal, like 2.5 liters per minute or 2.5, I mean, index. So there were some things that we had learned in the animals which really didn't relate to what we found out in supporting patients.
Were those systems in existence before you started working with NASA?
No, the centrifugal pump and the roller pump. The roller pump actually was first devised by Dr. Bakey back in 1934 when they were using it for transfusion. He was rolling blood from one patient to another. And then in the 1950s, they were developing cardiopulmonary bypass, and he was visiting Dr. Gibbon, who had a new device out, and he said, "Why don't you try my pump?" And so that was incorporated then into the cardiopulmonary bypass. So the roller pump had been used for a period of time, and then later on the centrifugal pump was developed and used for this purpose. But as far as the axial flow, and there was one pump which is called the hemopump, and that's what really told us that you could get by. And the hemopump was a small pump that was implanted within the vascular system, which sucked blood out of the heart. And this thing was turning around 25,000 revolutions per minute without causing any significant hemolysis after they got it developed. So we said, if they can do that at 25,000 revolutions per minute, we should be able to do it at a lower revolutions and still get minimal hemolysis and the damage to the blood.
If I could add to that, you know, part of the collaboration was with NASA, was with Lockheed Martin's engineers that were providing engineering services to NASA as part of that contract. So it really brought in to play a lot of people in one place that was very close to Houston that had the designers, that had the mechanics, that had the technicians, had people that were familiar with axial pumps, had people that were interested, you know, knew power supplies and wiring and all those kinds of things that you need, along with the facilities to do the testing. It was sort of one-stop shopping that we could also tap in the resources of larger, vast technical corporation that really provided that kind of marriage of many different organizations that brought that to place.
So I'll answer your question about conflict of interest. There's actually a couple aspects of that. First of all, I'm not a clinician. I'm a PhD investigator in a clinical department. So, and there's two types of clinical evaluations that we need to be considering. One of the reasons that we've been so successful in getting an innovative product developed so quickly is that we have had access to people early on in our development. So I think there's a real benefit to developing technology sort of in the home of your customer. And so when there are, when we do human evaluation very early, and some of the initial evaluation we do in our laboratory under the supervision of physicians who are in my department. But as soon as we get to the point where we need to test safety and efficacy, then we do it outside my laboratory. And in fact, we've been especially grateful to NASA because we have three systems at Johnson Space Center, and we've had them here for a couple years, and we've probably done thousands of human subjects and gotten feedback on the performance of our system from a user perspective, which has been invaluable in creating the automation that will go into both the system we'll give back to NASA in a better format, as well as what will end up in being our product. And in terms of publishing, we always disclose the relationship with the company even before we've had funding. We've always been very transparent that there are patents and the patents will be licensed and that in the future there could be financial return.
Hi, Dave Watson with NSBR, and I want to just tag on to the bit to the question from the gentleman from JAXA, if I can. And we had heard some discussion yesterday about the addition of animal capabilities on ISS, and so I would like to just ask Dr. Becker and I guess Dr. Pellis and maybe others on the panel as well, if you believe it's important to further downstream commercial development of vaccines or other things to have this animal capability on board?
Yeah, real fast answer is absolutely. It's absolutely important, and in fact, the animal work that has been conducted on Shuttle was with Procter & Gamble sponsoring for a therapeutic development. And so, no, this is a critical need. Yeah.
Good answer. Many of us like to see it added, so.
How you doing? Patrick Maloney from Rice University, formerly of NASA. Oh, I'll stand up as well. Patrick Maloney of Rice University, formerly of NASA JSC. A question for the entire panel. Do they feel that NASA does a good job at tech transfer? And if not, what would you do to improve it? And then second part to that, do you feel that NASA does a good job in allowing small companies to collaborate with your scientists on new technology? And if not, what would be the paths to try and improve that?
I guess I'll jump in on that one since we did spin off some tech transfer out of NASA. I think there's a couple of obstacles with the tech transfer. Number one is finding out what NASA has. And that's the biggest obstacle. NASA has so much technology that could be used, disseminating it. I think it was mentioned by one of the other panel members, the information sometimes even goes to the wrong commercialization group, or the type of technology isn't, the breadth of the technology maybe isn't identified. So I think one of them is getting the technology out. Once the technology is out and a company forms a relationship with NASA, the next obstacle is negotiating the license agreement. In our case, we were looking for an exclusive license, which just about takes an act of Congress. You know, it took about one entire year to negotiate an exclusive license. The importance of that is as a small company, if you only have a non-exclusive license, you'll never get funding. No one's going to put money in your company when any other company can have access to that technology. So negotiating the exclusive license is another key obstacle to the tech transfer. Once you get past that, the cooperation that you get from NASA is astounding. Even after Micromed was formed and the technology was commercialized, we still had access to Do-Chan Kwok, Chet and Kiris at the NASA Ames Research Center. We had access to some of the expertise at Johnson Space Center. So once you can get through the bureaucratic steps to actually get the license, then the portion of the partnership afterwards is really nice and really that's better than any other academic institutions we work with. So it's just getting to the point where you've licensed the technology and find the technology. That's the hurdle.
I'll address the second question from the perspective of my interaction with NSBRI and what I know about the interaction of the Exploration Medical Capabilities Group and their SBIR program, which is the way I think most small companies get involved with NASA. I have to say that it's evolving and it's improving. I know in the Exploration Medical Capabilities area, we're trying to bring the SBIR projects and align them with NASA's risks and goals, and we're trying to integrate them with the NSBRI teams that have projects in the same area. So I think there's definitely an effort involved in merging the portfolios, both from the small companies as well as the university investigators and the NASA internal investigators.
Okay, I believe we're about out of time. And I'd like to again thank the panel for their very informative comments and observations this morning and dialogue. Thank you.
I got to thank Brewster for the promotion.